Yo, this one goes out to sex afflictions and addictions. Oh, yeah.
We tell you how to survive and thrive, to restore intimacy and love to your life, to overcome porn and sex addiction. Ain't no easy task, man, it's a mission. But tune in and take a listen, and we'll teach you how to get back to living. Responsibility and integrity, for that mindfulness and positive energy. Tune in to Sex Afflictions and Addictions at Spreaker.com/user/sex-addiction.
Hello, everybody. This is Craig.
And it's Mishka, and I just love your radio voice, Craig. Well, everybody, welcome to our show. This is Sex Afflictions and Addictions. And we are hoping, through our show, to bring the topic of sex and porn addiction out to the light of day and begin to start taking control of our lives, our happiness, and our relationships.
So, yeah, if you guys have been joining us for the first time, my name is Craig, and this is my wife, Mishka, Michelle, and we've been happily married for 14 years, and we have survived.
And thrived.
And thrived. I like it when she says it better.
I don't know why.
Ed's sex and porn addiction, and just kind of went insane, and didn't do the right thing, and learned a lot about myself in the journey, and brought us much closer together, and now we want to be a voice for other people. There's nobody to look up to for a lot of people. And we hope to be that. As,
You're kind of off today, huh?
A little off today.
Well, basically what he's saying is that a lot of people suffer through this. A lot of couples suffer through this in silence. There's so many people, so many men, women, marriages that are suffering because of this, and nobody talks about it. So we're out here trying to talk about it, trying to bring awareness to the topic and give people support, let you know that you're not alone. We've been through it. We're together. We're better than ever.
We want everyone to know that...
Wow, that's long.
Wow, does it ever stop? You always have a choice, and you are powerful. So thank you for joining us. We've got a very exciting show here today. So why don't you tell everyone what we're going to talk about?
So today, our recovery song that rocks is Katy Perry, Part of Me. I've been avoiding Katy Perry for like since we started this podcast. I'll tell you why. But I've got to include her in it. So we're going to talk about her. We're going to talk about change and embracing change through crisis. And that's really a really important piece to recovery. We're going to talk about sex addiction in the news, Mishka's moment of Zen, and our recovery tip of the week.
That is absolutely a riveting, riveting show.
Isn't it riveting?
I'm riveted.
That's a great big word.
Riveting? It is. It is a big word.
What does riveting even mean?
Captivating.
Okay, this is just not going great today. So last week, our recovery song of the week.
And that's okay, by the way. I mean, let's just put it out there, right? So we're feeling kind of like a little bit in a funk because things have been crazy.
Well, it's not that we're in a funk. It's that we're just so busy trying to... We're in the process of... picking up all the pieces that were thrown all over the place in the insanity of what had happened. And so we're using this, and which is why speaking of change and crisis is so important to us. And we really connect with that because that's what we did. We've just totally embraced change, and we're trying to reinvent ourselves and our lives. We've never been this connected and happy and awake. And so we're reinventing ourselves, and we've got like 8 million projects going on, and every once in a while, it just gets very overwhelming, and we just stop. And
today
we're like,
was
oh
one
my
of
God.
Those days.
Today was one of those days. And so we had our show today. We didn't want to skip it, but I think we're feeling a little off, and we're probably not as prepared as we should be. But that is an important thing that I always want to let people know, women especially, because we put so much pressure on ourselves, that it is okay to not be perfect. We are all perfectly imperfect. And the fact is we're never going to, you know, be the best at everything. We're going to have our off days. We're going to have our days where we just want to scream and cry. We're going to have the days where we're so happy we're jumping off the walls. We're going to have our days where we want to hide in a corner. Or you can't even think straight. And it's okay.
And that's a perfect segue when we get to it, through the crisis through change. Because that's where the growth happens. And that's where things things can really change for you. But let's talk about the song.
Well,
the song
I have
of the week.
Yes.
I need a little bit of motivation. Right. I know this is probably going to depress me. But
Well, okay. The song of the week is important. But I do need to state something. Last week, okay, this is really important. Last week, our song of the week was You're Still the One by Shania Twain.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
No, wait, this is funny.
We've got some great listeners out there who did some homework, did some research.
Well, so.
And did some digging.
So, yeah. And
gave
so,
us the rest of the story.
Well, so, you know, it was a really motivating song. Like, we're still together after all this time. Everybody said we wouldn't make it. Look at us now. Blah, blah, blah. Really nice song. So, anyway. I found out since then that the guy that Shania Twain wrote that for, her husband, had cheated with her best friend. So that's really not good. So they got divorced, and then Shania ended up marrying that best friend's husband. So there's a little bit of drama in that whole recovery song of the week. I don't really know what to say about that, but it's kind of funny.
Well, yeah, no, it's because it's a song of such inspiration and hope. And you know, and oftentimes.
And then he cheated with her best friend.
And oftentimes.
That's just your best friend. Her best friend.
They're trying to fucking ruin our show.
Her best friend.
Yeah, no, that's, how low can you go? How low can you go?
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, so, but we do have an interesting song this week. And, you know, the famous sex addiction couple out there is Russell Brand and Katy Perry, no longer together. He's don't know where he's at, but he was very open, very vocal about it. And they had a short relationship, but being an artist, she kind of came up with this. A couple songs, actually, she wrote about it.
Well,
right?
Here's the thing with her story is that she's. Her story has been haunting me. Her songs just like play in my ear every 2 minutes. And there's part of me, which is, it's the name of the song. There's a part of me that gets a little annoyed whenever I hear her songs because they've been together a very short, they were together a very short time.
How short?
They were, I don't know.
How short?
They were dating not too long before they got married, I think. And they were married for... Okay, enough. That was so... It was funny the first two times. It's not funny that time.
I'm a one-trick pony. What do you want me to tell you?
You really are. So they were only married like a year or 18 months or something, 13, 14 months. But, you know, she's got all the money in the world. You know, she's beautiful. She could have any guy... She could have anybody she wants. She has all the money in the world. What does it matter to her? Not what does it matter, but that was my first instinct. And I was just like, oh, you know, you don't even know what it's like to be in our shoes. That's what I was thinking. And her songs keep, like, getting in my face and haunting me. And then the other day I said to myself...
Is that because you're a firework?
Oh, silly words. You're a firework. Come on, baby. Show me what you're worth. Anyway, that's just...
You're a firework.
I am. So, but then I stopped and I said, hey, I am totally judging her. What does it matter how long she's been with him? All our pain is relative. Just because she has lots of money and they weren't together so long doesn't mean that she's not suffering terribly. So anyway, I decided to open my mind and I said, you know what? And I listened to the song Part of Me and I said, this is a great song. It's a great song for spouses that are like, you know, their guys or their addict spouse is not getting their shit together. It's a great one for even if you stay with your spouse of maintaining the control within yourself and empowering yourself not to get sucked down into any of that anymore. And it's also, I think, great for the addict talking to his addict saying, you know,
days
F
like
you.
This, I want to drive away. I want to pack my bags and watch your shadow fade. You chewed me up and spit me out like I was poison in your mouth. You took my light. You drained me down. But that was then, and this is now.
Now look at me. So let's play a little bit of this song. I don't know how to do it.
Here we go. Check it out. Katy Perry's Part of Me on Sex Addictions and Afflictions.
Days like this.
a cool tune. I really like it. I mean, you know what? I knew the song, and I've heard it so many times.
So many times.
On the radio. It haunts, but I really don't listen to the words sometimes when I know it's her.
Right.
And I probably should, because she's got some killer tunes. I love Fireworks. That one I think is really, really cool.
Okay. He has an app on his phone, and it has like six effects, and that's really all that is. Okay, so, and I love the part, I love turning it into, you know, obviously it's obvious for the person who's been burned. It's obvious for the person who's been betrayed. It's obvious for, you know, the spouse to get, you know, get control of their own self-esteem. It is obvious, but even for you, you know, you could be, this, you know, to your addict, you know, this is the part of me that you're not going to take away from me. You do not have control over me. So let's go to the next one.
I just want to.
You ripped me off. Your love was cheap, was always tearing at the seams. I fell down. You let me down, but that was then, and this is now. Now look at me. This is the part of me that you're never going to ever take away from me. I lost my spot.
Let's listen a little bit more.
I just want to throw my phone.
I really like that part. Okay. Now look at me. I'm sparkling. I mean, it's a little cheesy, but sparkling. She loves that.
She likes to sparkle.
A firework, a dancing flame. But this is the part I really like. Okay. You won't ever put me out again. I'm glowing. Oh, whoa, whoa. So you can keep the diamond ring, which obviously if you're staying with your spouse or you're talking to your addict, just ignore that line. It doesn't mean anything anyway. In fact, you can keep everything except for me.
That's cool. Yeah. I like what? It. It's all right. Not my favorite recovery song of the week, but...
I didn't think it was going to be your favorite recovery song of the week, but it's not all about the addict. It's not all about you.
Wait a minute.
That's my point. No, it's not about you.
Time out.
It's about women. It's about women getting their control and saying, you are not going to take, this is the part of me that you're not going to take away from me. Whether we're together or not, you're not going to take any of this away from me. Because look at me. I'm sparkling. I'm a firework, a dancing flame.
Do you mean to tell me that you're...
You won't ever put me out again.
You're stealing
my segment. Dude, you will never put me out again. And you could keep my diamond ring. Well, I'm going to keep that anyway because it's worth a lot of money. And it does mean something to me. But you know what I mean. You could throw your sticks and your stones and throw your bombs and your blows, but you're not going to break my soul. And women, if you cannot stay with your husband, that is powerful. And if you are staying with your husband, it doesn't matter. It is powerful because you will never break my soul. You will never break any of you guys, any of you women. Don't let anybody break your soul, whether you're with them or not. You are powerful.
Nobody should break anybody's soul.
You are awesome and you are fabulous. So you need to believe it, own it, and be a firework.
And for the record, we are anti-soul breaking. That is our official position here at Sex Addictions and Afflictions.
But really, you're like, it's not my favorite song. Your songs are only good if you only like them. The country songs, too. You're like, yes, my favorite, but...
No, I got into the country songs.
Well, that's true. You did.
But you know what? You made a good point. You're right, and it's so true because I didn't like it because it didn't hit me right away. But now, as you so artfully just explained to me, thank you for that. You're very persuasive when you...
When I'm feisty.
When you get feisty. But, you know, it helps me see it from that perspective. And so much of what I need to learn and what us guys need to learn is empathy. And so music is, this is really kind of the whole point of this segment, right? And I'm being a little funny. It didn't hit me, but now it does. Oh, yeah, I get it.
And what? But what about the women who their men are not waking up? Their men are, you know.
I don't have a problem. How often do we hear that from people who call or from people who write?
That the guys say they don't have a problem.
I don't have a problem.
Or they say, well, I have a problem. I'll get a little help. But they hang on. They're still online. They're still fishing. They're still making bad choices.
And their life sucked. That's the sad part of it, right?
And for the woman who can't stay in their relationship, and I don't think they should, if the guy isn't committing, then it's a long and lonely life. Then this song is fabulous for them because we need to support them too. We are here to support, you know, everybody, the whole situation. So anyway, that's why I like the song. And you know what, ladies? You rock. You're fabulous. All right? Be fabulous.
Be okay. Fabby.
All right. So I think we should go to a commercial.
Let's go to a commercial. All right. We'll be right back. With sex addictions and...
It's sex afflictions and addictions.
Oh, my gosh.
It's on mute.
No, it is not on mute. This train you hear is the wreck of our show crashing. So we do it live. You don't have to edit it. We just throw ourselves out there. You know what? Good, bad, ugly. Here we are. We love you very much. Watch out. We're going to crash. Help. Should I sound the foghorn too? Yes, I should. Foghorn.
Okay, sorry for this train wreck of a show, but you know what?
So the next concept, though, is a deeply one I deeply connect with, because I think when you're able to get this, it has that transformative effect, that impact. The only, you know, you hear the expression, the only constant is change, and I love that expression.
Sorry.
I'm literally talking. And I look over and see her laughing at me, looking at me and laughing.
Because you're showing me your with your hands what you're talking about. But I know what you're talking about. And it's just funny. There's nobody else watching you. You're just listening and you're using your hands so enthusiastically. I'm sorry. Okay. Change. Go.
So I don't even know where the heck I was, but go on.
I was reading something from Tony Robbins, who's just completely inspires me. I think he's just...
We love Tony. What's up, Tony?
Oh, if he listened to our show, that would be so cool. And I read something from him, and it just hit me. It was amazing. So,
and by the way, just real quick, TonyRobbins.com had a free coaching session available. Now, yeah, they were selling their coaching piece, but you will get something out of it. I promise you that. The coaches are phenomenal.
And
we're life coaches. We know they are phenomenal.
And
so,
they have this thing that's for free, which is where I got this. Do this little coach for training for coaches, where you just get these emails and they give you this stuff. I mean, obviously they want you to buy more, but it's very informative. So this is what I read, okay? And it was just awesome. Most problems can be solved through A, presence.
And B, strategy.
And this is what's important. Everybody listen and take notes. In crisis lies opportunity, because crisis destabilizes everything. It enables you to see situations with a fresh set of eyes and reassemble what's there into something that is much more meaningful.
Why? What does crisis do? What does?
Well, for me, what crisis does is crisis makes you stop in your tracks and say, this isn't working. This cannot go on anymore. Because the difference between a crisis and just a problem is easy to dust under the rug. A problem is easy to kind of ignore.
Like the guy who's on the internet all, you know, 2-3 hours a night, he's working, researching. But
or the guy who's stopping.
What he's doing.
Or the guy who's stopping at the strip club on the way home and, you know, whatever, doing stuff that's not so bad, but, you know, in his eyes. But, and that's a problem. But it's easy to, or as the woman to see, I see something that's going on, but you know what? I can't deal with this now, and I'm going to brush the problem under the rug. So a problem is easy to push to the side. A crisis, you have no choice. Whatever is going on isn't working, and a crisis there has to be a change, because if there's no change, when you're in crisis, you're at a crossroads. So what happens in a crisis is everything's kind of just like thrown all over the place.
No, but you can go through the crisis. You know, listen, it happens, right? Where we know people. I'm playing devil's advocate because I want to unpack this a little bit because it is so powerful. But people in the crisis, you know, come out of it. They, you know, they don't do the. It seems like, you know, it's an opportunity. You know what it is? It's an opportunity to embrace change through crisis. And you're right. So when you're down, when something bad happens, when there is that pivotal moment. So for example, there have been two relatively prominent prostitution busts in the country over the course of the past couple of weeks. Because we get calls from all over the country, we hear about these things. Guys call, reach out, their spouses call. One was in Kennebunkport, Maine. Ooh. The other was in Tampa, Florida. And you know, and we talked to guys who are, you know, whose names have been exposed, and whose, you know, professional reputations they feel have been ruined forever. And clearly, that's a wonderful opportunity, right? Because you can either wallow in self pity, or you can decide to make some profound changes in your life. And I've talked to some very powerful men who are doing just that, and they're not stuck. They're moving out of it. They're moving away from it.
Right, but when you're in that, okay. So when you're in a crisis and the pieces are all thrown all over the place, because that's what crisis is. Crisis is like 911. Pieces are thrown all over the place. You have two choices. You can put the pieces back together the way they were. Okay, you can't ignore it, but you can put the pieces back together the way they were.
They don't they don't fit the same way though, do they? After a crisis,
that's right.
Do they? There's something about the crisis that causes them to just not fit. I like that analogy.
Well, then that's because there's a different awareness. Whereas before, when it was a problem, you brushed it off. Now, when there's a crisis, you cannot brush it off. So the awareness is there. So you can either put the pieces back the way they were, which the way they were wasn't working, or you can use it as an opportunity. And what this says is looking at it through fresh eyes, looking at the pieces all thrown all over the place and looking at how you can put it together differently, how you can build on the pieces and see really what wasn't working in your life and create the life that you want to live. And what he says here is, he goes, and guess what? You pull out of the crisis, you take advantage of your resources, and later you'll find yourself grateful that the crisis happened. And why, he asks? Well, I'll tell you why. Because it forced you to make things even better.
So think about that for a second. If you're listening to the show, you're struggling or you have struggled and you've overcome something, you're standing here, you're living proof. If you're a couple listening, you are living proof that there's hope, that things can change. And, you know, I don't know if you may ever get to a place where, I'm glad this happened, right? I'm glad that you don't have to do that. But I know some of the guys I talk to, like, man, I hope I look back one day and say, oh, this is all worth it, maybe, or this is worth it. And the fact is, they overwhelmingly do, because it forces them to change their life in profound ways and to develop a deeper, more intimate relationship first with themselves, then to their spouse and their kids, their friends, their family, and their work, their vocation. It has a profound transformative effect on every facet of their lives, because when your sex is screwed up, your life is screwed up. You think you're hiding it, but you're not. You may be hiding the acts or the deeds, but the dysfunction is visible to those people around you. They feel it. You feel it. They do too.
And they might be talking about it, but that energy is there.
The energy
is there. So there's a split in the connection that you have. You're not being as connected to those around you. And, you know, I would never say I'm glad what happened. Never in a million years. I would never wish it again. But at the same time, we wouldn't be where we are today. You know, we wouldn't be this connected. You wouldn't
have been on Anderson Cooper.
I wouldn't have been on Anderson Cooper. And I owe that all to you, buddy. Thank you.
Thank you.
High five to you.
Thank you.
Yeah. But
We promise you, you can laugh about this someday.
But you know,
definitely an opportunity to do that.
But we're forced to work on our relationship. So your
and
life.
I had to work on me. I had to work on me or lose everything.
That's right.
That's right.
And so the pieces are all over the place, and you have those two choices. And if you can accept the change and say, you know what, I'm not going down like that.
I ain't going out like that.
I am going to create the life, the happiness that I want, because it sucks to not have your own happiness and to do what you want in life and to have the life that you want. So you work on it. But before, when life was just ho-hum, and that's a lot of couples, whether they have sex addiction in their relationship or not, they end up, you know, 10, 20 years later with this, just average, just kind of going through the motions kind of life. And they're not forced to take the steps to work on themselves and their relationship. So they just go about life and they're like, oh, that's okay. But when you...
Mediocrity.
Yes.
Average.
That's right. So
boring.
But when there's this crisis and it's like, it forces you to say, this is not working. I'm going to and you're almost more like, I am going to create what I want, because you feel more passionate about it. You feel powerful. You've been burned and you want what you deserve. And so I think it puts you in a place to open your mind and really see, gives you the opportunity to grow, to just do all the things that you can in life to create that life that you want, and do the work, do the hard work. Because if you don't do the work, then it's going to be really hard. But if you commit to work and commit to the change, walk into the discomfort and just love it, be it, it really can be a really powerful point in your life.
Own your shit, my brothers. We'll be right back after this commercial break with sex addiction and the news. Hey, welcome back, everybody. Sorry for that. This is Craig with Sex Afflictions and Addiction with my lovely bride, Mishka, coming at you from Sacramento, California. And this is a political season. We've got some really interesting news coming up. But I want to talk about a Brooklyn nanny. So just picture this scene. This wonderful woman, Crystal Brister, takes her kids to the library. She watches these great kids, and she's... Oh, God, what a safe place for children. Oh, yes or no? The library, safe place for children.
It should be.
You cannot watch porn at the library, can you?
I'm going to vote no.
Why would anyone in their right mind be watching porn at the library? Well, because for the same reason we went to the moon, because you can. So pornography.
It's like watching porn on a plane.
Porn on a plane, porn on a library, porn in public, in my opinion, is inappropriate, potentially illegal if children are exposed, risk of injury to minor, she's not allowed to show kids porn, distribute porn to kids. So there's a whole bunch of legal ramifications that are that may present themselves, but this wonderful woman, Crystal Brister, was in the library, loves taking care of the children and reading to them, and she's at the library, and here's what she says. The first thing I see is a full-blown porno playing, and I'm like, that, and this is her word, right? That can't be right. That can't be right. She complained to library employees, and what do you think, and my friends out there, what do you think the library employees did?
I would hope that the library employees walked right over and said, hey, buddy, get the porn out of here. That's not appropriate, and there's little kids here. That's what I hope happened.
No.
And there's
No, it's funny.
How could that not happen?
There's a big debate in the library community because libraries don't want to censor. It's a government body, can't censor. Guess
but
what
porn?
Amendment? Protected by what? The First Amendment to the United States Constitution.
But kids are there.
I don't make the rules.
Nobody's
I don't write constitutional
don't
law.
Don't watch porn.
This is a
debate.
Just
wait till you get home. Why can't you wait till you get home? Why do you need to be in a library to watch?
So, parents, you need to know that pornography...
Wait, you never said what they did.
Nothing. They did nothing. They said sorry.
So what did Bristol What is her name?
She's starting a petition. Change.org. Check it out. Her name is Crystal Brister, B-R-I-S-T-E-R. Sign her petition. This is in Brooklyn Public Library in Clinton Hill. This is a huge debate in the library community. But parents, you need to know that some librarians, number one, will not put filtering on their computers because of the First Amendment issue. And we can talk about that more if you're interested. Most people aren't, but I'll just tell you, it's a free speech issue. And the courts are on their side. Number two.
Watching porn, I mean, really?
Number two.
I just...
Well, what if it's sex ed? Should they be allowed to watch sex ed?
You know what?
How does a librarian making 30 grand, 50 grand, 20 grand, whatever it is,
make that distinction? Why does any kid need to be watching sex ed in the library anyway?
Listen, these are fine lines that are very, very difficult. That some say they're difficult to draw. I necessarily don't think so. I think there is a line, and there's a whole movement in the library community to do that. But support Crystal. Check her out on change.org. Sign her petition for a porn-free library.
Good for her. Well, good for her for doing something about it and taking a stand.
So this week was
respect that.
Major props to Crystal. Big week for porn. Pornhub.com just announced that it was going to sponsor the Susan Komen Breast Foundation. Remember we talked about that?
Breast Cancer Foundation.
The Breast Foundation. For every click of every look of a breast, the company was going to donate money. This was potentially a seven-figure donation. They said no. The Susan Komen Breast Cancer Foundation said no. But a couple of guys, comefor.org, is going to function like a social network. It's going to have profiles, content, and free user-generated content. And they are going to show pornography. And for every dollar made off pornography, all profits are going to go to nonprofits. All profits will be donated to nonprofit institutions. This is a $100 billion industry worldwide. And now there's some people make questions whether or not charitable organizations will accept donations from a porn site. I just talked about the Komen Foundation adamantly rejected a large donation from a mainstream porn site.
So why are they doing that? Just because porn is so big, they say we can raise so much money?
Well, a couple things. And here's what the guy say. Many people consuming free pornography think that the only risk they may run into is that of being discovered by others. That idea is not just naive, it's wrong. For the current model of consuming online sexual content has many negative implications for all of us.
Right, so I don't understand. If that's how they feel, why are they putting a site up?
Is porn intrinsically bad? No. So what they want to do is they want to be part of the next sexual revolution. It's in the donation upstart phase. They're going to divert a small portion of the mainstream porn profits to charities while promoting a more ethical, transparent industry.
Wait, you just said they were donating everything to
in their startup phase. In their startup phase.
Sorry.
So it's fascinating. It's fascinating.
So they want to do like better porn?
They want to do better porn, not the abuse, not the objectification of women, real people, real love, real intimacy, and who knows, ethical user uploaded videos.
Interesting.
They want to redirect revenues to charities and letting a flow of ethical user uploaded videos shape and drive their new site. They believe that they can foster a healthy culture that reflects the natural plurality of human sexuality. So wow. When you think of the money that's being made in porn, you are going to see more creative philanthropic ways or social, we've talked about even in Compulsion Solutions, green porn.
Yes.
Because porn is so violent. The talent is treated so poorly. These women are chewed up and spit out within 6 months in the industry after doing hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of scenes. And so it's going to be really interesting to see what happens with these kinds of organizations and what impact it does have, because there's so much negativity around it. What's going to happen remains to be seen. And speaking of pornography, who do you think the pornographers are going to vote for? Are they going to vote for Obama or are they going to vote for Mitt Romney? Pornography, big business. Who do you think they want?
Obama?
They most definitely want Obama. They most definitely want Obama. 68% of respondents in the adult industry told XBiz, which is a industry trade publication, that they prefer Obama. And only 13% said they prefer Romney. Mitt Romney has been outspoken about pornography. Mitt Romney
has talked about sex addiction too, right? No.
He may have mentioned sex addiction. I don't remember. But this is no surprise because Pat Truman, who is president of the anti-porn nonprofit Morality and Media, he's a friend, and these guys do a lot of good work out there just trying to bring some decency to the airwaves and protect children from pornography. And they've accused the Obama administration of being soft on the porn industry. And here's what he says. The Obama administration has refused to initiate even one indictment against an illegal pornographer. Federal law prohibits the distribution of obscene or hardcore pornography on the internet. The Justice Department didn't respond to a request. However, the porn industry, some say, are flourishing under the Obama administration, would have to draw down the level of severe content that they're offering under Mitt Romney. And so that is another issue that we're going to follow throughout this political season. And the big issue affecting porn is Proposition B, Measure B in California, which is the AID Healthcare Foundation attempt to compel the porn industry to wear condoms. The industry says that this law, if passed, so right now porn actors and actresses can choose whether or not to wear condoms on a porn set.
That just doesn't seem safe.
To not wear them or to wear them? Yeah, well, it's their choice, right? This is, and sex is free. They're doing it. This is their job. And the AIDS Foundation said, listen, you should be regulated like any other industry that has to deal with the exchange of bodily fluids. Just because it's sex doesn't excuse you from the OSHA regulations. And so they actually have a ballot in LA County called Measure B, and it's going to require the industry to potentially wear condoms. Some say that's going to force the industry out of LA. There aren't many places that they can go, but this is another hot issue on the ballots. And what the porn performers say is that they would be required to use condoms, goggles, gloves, dental dams, and other protective gear in shooting porn. So it's going to be really, really interesting to see where this issue goes. This is a huge debate in LA, and you can just, you know, Google it and find out a whole bunch of more information if you're interested. This is going to be a fascinating political season with less than a month or a month and a little few days away, and that's how newsworthy I am, right, to the election. But porn did play a part. Rick Santorum, who was a candidate for president, was pretty out there. And so that is all we have on sex addiction and the news. We'll take a short commercial break, and we will be right back.
I'm Katy Perry.
We are back. Hello, everybody. This is Craig and
Mishka.
Sex Afflictions
and Addictions.
So what's up? We got a recovery tip of the day. What do you want to talk about?
Okay, so what I want to talk about is completely, completely goes with the what we were talking about change. So my tip is to growth does not happen without discomfort. You cannot grow and improve your life and improve where you are without walking into the discomfort, without being uncomfortable.
The only constant is change.
That's true. So walking into the change is so important. When you're faced with discomfort, but it's for something that you want, walk into it, open your arms, and literally go there. Literally embrace it and say, I welcome this. You're not going to die.
Well, that's the funny thing, right? And this is something that I learned around intimacy. It's like, okay, I'm not going to die if I embrace, if I cuddle, if I hug, if I kiss, if I touch. And
you might even like it.
Yes, 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 yes. And that's the crazy part. So when you have that feeling like there's no fucking way I'm doing that. You know, there's no way, or there's no way I'm apologizing to my wife because, you know, that bitch was yelling at me about something. You know, I mean, you get that, right?
Did you say that? That's mean.
I didn't say that, but clients have said, I'm sure I did. Yeah, everyone says that. And so what did I say?
You're just being a little defensive. So of course I've said that to you. And we've talked about it. You're being a little defensive today.
Isn't that what I said?
Yeah, whatever.
I thought
you're just kind of annoying today.
I am officially annoying, ladies and gentlemen. So, yeah. And so just really recognize I'm in a safe place. I'm not going to, what's going to happen? You know, just go with the experiment. See what happens. Lean into discomfort. It's such an important lesson. I learned it actually of all places at work for a $40 billion a year company where we had to take these classes on growth and development and diversity and challenging yourself. And, you know, it's kind of the boring corporate crap. No, they were very powerful. And one of the most important things I learned was to constantly lean into discomfort. And for a good part of at least my professional life, that was a theme. Take jobs that maybe I wasn't qualified for. Do something different. And that's where I learned probably the most is when I leaned into discomfort.
And especially with the recovery with sex addiction, the important thing is to take small baby steps. Because, what happened? Small baby steps are important because they help you lean into discomfort, but also feel safer at the same time. So small baby steps add up to very big, great steps. So I just want to encourage everybody, be uncomfortable. See what makes you feel uncomfortable, but that a direction that you want to go, and start building a plan to get there. Start taking baby steps. Start working on little small exercises and keep building on them.
And do something different, which is a perfect segue into the moment of Zen, right? If you do something different.
I always do the moment of Zen.
You are going to do it. I am not going to do it.
It's called Mishka's moment of Zen. It's not called Craig's moment of Zen.
So walk into the change. Do something different for a change. Lean into that discomfort and see what happens. Because something really cool might grow from the seed that you planted.
So Mishka's moment of Zen today is just that. If you do what you've always done, you will get what you always have gotten. So we must make a change to experience change.
Big theme of the day is change, isn't
change.
It?
Change.
Turn and face the.
And how change? You can look at change one of two ways. You can look at change as scary, overwhelming, and crippling, or you can look at change as scary, overwhelming, and an opportunity.
That's exactly right. And so you get to choose because you always have a choice.
And you are the one that's powerful.
So, yeah, really look for those opportunities. They're everywhere. And start with small things. Start with maybe going to a different place for lunch or whatever pattern you're in. Identify that pattern, be aware, and try to disrupt it and see what happens.
And bring that feeling to the light of out. Like, talk about it with your partner. Have a discussion on it. Because when you open your mind, voicing these things, make them more real than when you just think them, and it's easy to shove them away when you just keep them in your head. Voice them. Write them down.
I think I need a little bit more Katy Perry. What do you think?
Okay.
Let's check it out. We are back. We are back.
And we just want to say goodbye, everybody. So thank you for staying with us on our not quite so organized and rusty and, I don't know, out of sorts show. But I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you might have learned something. Maybe you laughed.
Change is good. What you're doing is not working.
You what?
You always have a choice.
Didn't we say that? Well, and you are powerful.
And you're powerful.
So just remember, in the end, you can't change the past and you can't predict the future. All we have is right here and right now. So thanks for spending it with us. We'll see you next time.
Love you guys. Bye-bye.